Praise the Lord. Mommy started with us with the book of Jonah last week. And she shared with us, she first did the summary of Habakkuk, but then she went to the book of Jonah, chapter 1. And she analyzed to us that there's some miracles in the book of Jonah. She brought out 6 miracles. She talked about the miracle that God sent a violent wind. God provided a great fish to swallow Jonah. God ordered the fish to vomit Jonah. God made a vine to shed Jonah. God arranged a worm to eat the vine, and God arranged a scorching wind to blow on Jonah. And one of the interesting bits about this book of Jonah that really touched me was I looked at it and I compared it to the book of Psalm 145 that we've been reading. And I looked at verse 9. That in verse 9 of that of Psalm 145, it says, God is slow to anger. And he's also a compassionate God. And we saw that he showed this to Jonah. When Jonah was running away, God sent a fish. But God gave him a chance. And then further down in verse 13 of that same psalm, he said, God remembers us in our low estate. And it really touched me that God was so interested in us, even in our low estate. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. I'll just quickly go through Jonah chapter 1 and verse 2, which Mommy took us through last week. And verse 3 talks about Jonah wanting to run away from God. I just want to quickly reflect on Psalm 139 verse 7, whereby Debbie was saying that if he goes anywhere, God's spirit is there. So we've got to be aware of that in our dealings with the things that pertains to God. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. So we should be aware that God is everywhere. When we are sleeping, when we are awake, he's everywhere. So if that's the case, then we should make sure that we are striving to please him at all times. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. Quickly to verse 17, it says, Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and 3 nights. Now, Jesus mentioned in Matthew chapter 12, verse 40, that as Jonah was in the belly of the earth for 3 days and 3 nights, so shall also the Son of Man be. Praise the name of Jesus. Amen.
Praise the Lord. I just want to share on verse 7. It says, then the sailors said to each other, come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity. When I read this at home, what ministered to me, apart from what Mommy was ministering to us about last week, was the fact that these people did not take their situation for granted. They searched what is the reason behind what the situation that we are going through. A lot of us, we are going through situations in our life. It's now becoming part of us. We are not investigating what is responsible for that situation. These people were wise enough to be able to find out what is responsible for this turbulence until they now found out that it was Jonah. And also, the fact that Jonah knew who he was sent to. He was sent to Nineveh, but he refused. And just like Dickiness said, we cannot run from God. I liken that to the book of Psalm 139, that God says that he knows where we are. If we've gone to the sea, he's there. If we've gone to the dark, he's there. He will reveal himself in every situation, so we cannot run away from God. Amen.
What I learned from the book of Jonah, from 1 and 2, it says the book of Jonah portrayed that our God is a God of second chance. Because of God's mercy, Jonah disobeyed and did not disqualify him from service to God. Instead, God pursued him and used his reluctant prophet to change a great city. Because of God's mercy, a wicked city was given a second chance through repentance. As we read through the book, we can look for the places when God shows his mercy, and may the depth of the revelation of God's word cause our hearts to worship him.
Yeah, we read that Jonah is the son of Amittai, and he's being referred to as a runaway prophet or the prophet will disagree with God, which mommy told us last week. What really intrigued me again, as in other books, is that such as Zephaniah, is that in verse 1, it says the word of the Lord came to Jonah, which really fascinated me. And this deduces that it is a book of the prophets. And then continuing from, and again, God commissioned Jonah to go to Nineveh and he proclaimed Nineveh's doom because God saw their wickedness. So we shall see verse 2. But continuing from that, Jonah refused and disobeyed God. And then he was able again to, he thought it's God's providence to pay for his fear, to go on a ship to Tarshish. But this was not what God actually sent because he disobeyed God. And again, there were several miracles performed, two or three miracles performed in Jonah chapter 1, which Pastor Nick has mentioned. But the lessons I was able to learn from Jonah is first, we should not be the Jonah of chapters 1 and 2. We did not obey God's instructions. Another lesson is that we should not show God's services. We should not show God's...
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. We thank God. So that's what God wants us to hear tonight. I really want to appreciate you all for your contribution and for the boldness, because it's not easy to be bold to come and speak out like that. And today, like I said to you, we'll be analyzing the Jonah's prayer. Oh, what have I done? We'll be analyzing Jonah's prayer of thanksgiving. Before we go to analyze his prayer of thanksgiving, and if God permits, because the time is fast spent, then we'll go to Jonah chapter 3. It's quite an interesting book that from inside the fish, Jonah prayed, which is chapter 2, to the Lord. He's God, he said. And I was trying to show Pastor Nike here. Psalm 139 is one of the psalms that I've written. And you've all mentioned it. That shows that you are good and intelligent Bible student. He said, in my distress, I call to the Lord. So I really want to stem on that verse 1 before we go to analyze Jonah's prayer. I'll try to bring out some people that God sent that have excuses. You know, in our generation today, God is sending us, and many of us have excuses. I cannot do this because of my husband. I'm talking to women because my life as a woman always reflects me to face women first. We have several excuses. I cannot go because of my children. Even now that I'm married, get as it be. I get tired by the time I come from work. I don't cook before. We have various excuses for not going for the Lord. May this Jonah's experience help us. So that all our excuses we cease in the name of Jesus. Some even use that work, that business that God has opened up for us. We use it against God. But it takes us to hear it more and more again so that when that spirit comes to deal with us, will not yield to temptation. So, who can we relate this Jonah to when we begin to talk of other prophets? Look at the life of Moses. In the book of Exodus, that's what I would say, from inside the fish, Jonah prayed to the Lord his God. Inside the fish, it has to take the fish to swallow Jonah before Jonah could go on the mission. May God help us. Exodus chapter 3, verse 11. Let's quickly see what is written there, which you can compare to that Jonah chapter 2, verse 1. Let's quickly read it. But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" Ask your neighbor, is that you? Does that portray you? Is that a type of picture of yourself? Sometimes you are so afraid in your place of work. They are sitting very close to you. Who am I? Yeah, they won't listen to me. So you can see, because we can blame Jonah here. Moses did the same thing. Now let's go to Exodus chapter 4. Verse 1 again. Yes. Let's read it together. Moses answered, "What if?" Or listen to me and say, "The Lord did not appear to you." What are your excuses? You might have your own excuse now. So begin to let your excuse be parallel and there. Who are you? God knows that you are somebody. That's why God knows that he's there. He was a prophet. That's why he's sending him as a prophet. Let's look at verse 10, chapter 4. Let's read it together again. Moses said to the Lord, "O Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither is the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue." Ask your neighbor, is that you? Then let's quickly go to verse 13. I think I'm communicating, eh? But Moses said, "Oh Lord, please send someone else to do it." Jonah would have been the same. I want you to write it against that chapter 2 because of time. I wasn't able to show you. Then let's look at Gideon's excuse as well in the book of Judges chapter 6 verse 15. These are prophets, people that are leaders. But Lord, let's read it together because when I say I didn't see it, how come you are giving on? But Lord, Gideon asked, "How can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family." Ask your neighbor, is that you? I think you are getting there tonight. So that we won't blame Jonah, because I know a lot of us, since he started Jonah, mission, could go and talk to them. Did he? He was not bold. No. Is that you? Now I'm asking myself too. Then let's look at Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 6. From inside the fish, Jonah prayed to the Lord. Why should it take Jonah to get inside the... You know, it's a real miracle, because he's supposed to have been dead by the time he was thrown into the deep. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 6. "Ha, sovereign Lord," I said, "I don't know how to speak. I am only a..." Ask your neighbor now. Is that you? I just want to make it interesting, eh? So that you will know that you can't blame Jonah. We have many, many others, but for time, we have to go into this. But we thank God that God, a way comes to be true. From inside the fish, Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God. He said, "In my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me. In my distress," analyzing Jonah's Psalm 139, 7 to 10, is another one that we should have read, but because we've been reading it since. But you can put it on the screen before we go there. Psalm 139, 7 to 10. And let's read that. So we cannot run away. It's just something that's confirming it, that we cannot run away from God. Whatever whoever we are, whatever God says that is going to become of us, It will definitely be. Amen. So from inside the belly of the fish, let's begin to analyze Jonah's prayer. In my distress, I called to the Lord. And he did what? He answered me. From the depth of the grave, I called for help. And you listened. I want you to be responding to Jonah's response. From the depth of the grave, I called for help. And you do what? Listen to my cry. You hauled me into the deep. That is, the sailors threw him. It's a very big miracle, I tell you, because even if the fish did not swallow Jonah, we go to the depth of the bottom. He died because you can't swim without all these hose and everything that they put that people put on. You cannot swim. You would have died. So he was able to give a prayer of thanksgiving. Has God done something for us? How do we appreciate God for what he has done for us? You hauled me into the deep, into the very heart of the seas, and the current swirled about me. The current helped me until you moved me into the belly of the fish. All your waves and breakers, this thing that comes like that and, you know, swept over me. I said, I have been banished from your sight. Yet, I will look again towards your holy temple. The engulfing water threatened me. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. To the root of the mountains, I sank down. The earth beneath buried me in forever, but you brought my life up from the pit, O Lord. Does that look like a picture of somebody that has gone through in life? This Jonah's prayer of thanksgiving should be what we should follow. Let us go to Psalm, because it talks about, in my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me. Does that make you know... get to see some of the Psalms. From the depth of the grave, I called for help. From deep in the sea. That chapter 2, from 2 to 6, you can see Psalm 18, 4 to 6 there. Let's quickly see that Psalm 18, verses 4 to 6. Let's read it together.
The court of death.
Amen. And that you can see similar in Psalm 116. Those of you that have been going to name babies can see this Jonah's prayer there. So that shows to us that Jonah is a man of the word. That's what I want to prove to you. Are you a Christian? You only come to church on Sunday. Yeah, Apostle will preach, I know. Hey, you have slept. Apostle is not sleepy. He's studying and he's still coming to give you something. And you are taking it for granted. You don't let the word dwell richly in you. What does the Bible say? Amen. If the word of God dwells richly in you, wherever you find yourself, Jonah found himself in distress. He found himself in the position of the grave. He found himself, his life was ebbing away. He wrote it in this thing. He found himself at the foot of the mountain. He found himself in the very big ocean. And he ended up in the belly of the fish. Yet, the word of God, there was no Bible to read. Have you ever thought about that? I was reading it and, that's why I said I can't finish it that day. The belly of the fish, there was, because of the word of God, the light of God was shown in that place. Because you don't know how... If we have to look at that, to medical doctors, God forbid we don't want to operate us, but if they have to open us, the medical doctors need light. You can know how dark. inside of Jonah, the belly of the fish might have been. But the light of God was there. What was the light that was transforming Jonah? The word of God. Your word is a light to my feet and a lamp unto my house. So it was the word of God. The Psalms, that Jonah had known and had inside, that was what he was using as refreshing. That's what he was using as canopies. That is what using. Those are the toothpicks that he was using to pick himself and making his, that was what was getting Jonah to go on. So don't forget that Psalm 18, 4 to 6. And you can compare it also with Psalm 116. So in the belly of the fish, he began to speak about the Psalms. When my life was ebbing away, my life was disappearing. I don't even know what is wrong with me anymore. I'm confused. You can see in the belly of the fish. Look at all the sin. Tell me the sin in the belly of the fish, and I will tell you. He said, the engulfing... Here, because he talks about... There's a place that he talks about the shell that were all around him. Seaweed, okay, yes. Verse 5. He said, the engulfing water threatened me. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed were wrapped around my head. The roots of the mountain, to the roots of the mountains, I sank down. The earth beneath bared me in forever. But you brought my life up from the pit. Oh, Lord, my God. When my life was ebbing away, my life was disappearing, I'm fainting. Because in the belly of the fish, the shell, everything that the fish is eating, I'm going around there. You can look at the scene. He said, I remembered you, Lord, and my prayer rose to you, to your holy temple. There was no Bible there. The only Bible that Jonah had was the Bible, the word of God that he has really gotten into, he said. Those who cling to worthless idols, then he began to remember to praise God. Talking about worthless idol. Jonah thanked God for saving him and that he was not worshipped, that he was saved. That even at this time that this thing happened to him, he wants to thank God that he has been saved. That he does not cling to worthless idol. That's what he's talking about. Hence, he's referencing them in chapter 2. But he wants to thank God that this did not meet him when he was worshipping idol. But he was worshiping the God of Israel. That was what led to him being saved here. But he says one thing. He said, Jonah, with a song of thanksgiving, offered a sacrifice of thanks to God and paid his vow. But I, with a song of thanksgiving, what is that vow? A song of thanksgiving will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, and I will make good salvation. What I have vowed, I will make good salvation comes from the Lord. And the Lord commanded the fish. Jonah paid his vow. We didn't know the vow, but he's now confessed to us that he vowed to sing to God a song of thanksgiving. God demands that we sing song of thanksgiving to God. Amen? Amen. And peradventure, we have... I'm telling people, remind me, because I'm going to pay a lot of vows. There are things I'm trusting God for now, I'm telling you, that I really need to trust God for. Are you listening to what I'm telling you? They are serious as even my nurseries. I've never seen people sit exam and study exam like this before in my life. Even though I've been hearing. Are you listening to me? So I will sing songs of thanksgiving. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because it's very precious in my sight. I've never seen what has been happening in the church of God. This parent will come here, that will come here. You know, we have Shiloh Pillar. You hear a lot of things every day you come here. And we are praying for various things in the church. That's why you cannot afford, let me use it to chip it in, you cannot afford to sit down at home if you are off on any of these days. Try those of you that are very close to cathedral. Tuesdays and Thursdays, to come and sit down and pray. Many parents are going through. This is where we see it. We are seeing it happen. That we need to pray for our young ones Some are raising their own children, and some people are not raising their own children. Their children are getting some culture from outside and bringing to the children we are raising in the church. It's not easy for some parents. Are you listening to me? So we really need to offer prayer. It's only the one that you carry along that you can really be beaten and that you are hearing. Some are hiding their own. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because how can we speak this kind of thing out? It can be hard. People are crying. So I'm just trying to put like, why should we sing songs of thanks? Why should we pay a vow? There are a lot of people, if you can do this, mommy, just pray. If God answered this prayer, I said, no, I know, but remember, tell people that you have made a vow so that you not forget. Are you listening to me? The Lord will grant us understanding. Vow that we have to pay, that we are still in God. People have looked and said, this one will not last. Your friend has said, I know her. No, they can't last in God. But you are lasting in God. People have looked at your marriage and said, this marriage cannot last. But your marriage is lasting. People are looking at the relationship that you have and they say, no, this one cannot last. And it's lasting and you're enjoying, you know. You need to pay vows. You now, with a song of thanksgiving, offer the sacrifice of thanks to God and pay this vow. Let's see what the book of Psalm 116, verse 17. And that we can compare with that chapter 2, verse 9 of Jonah. Yes? Let's go. 1, 2, 3, go. I will sacrifice a thank offering to God and call on the name of the Lord. Let's look at the next verse because I know that this is I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, all you ministers. This should be in your head. This is the psalm for thanksgiving. When somebody gives back, we go and you understand. And Jonah, remember this, in the belly of the fish, carries the word of God everywhere. The only thing I can remind you again is that let the word of God dwell richly in us, even including myself, so that we can do greater justice. It was after this that the fish vomited Jonah on the dry land. This ends the second chapter of the book of Noah. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Amen. Let me quickly take you. Is there any question there? You want to add anything? God is giving you a revelation that is more than what I've just taught. I won't get to read my note, but I'm going straight into chapter 3 so that we can finish chapter 4 by next week by the grace of God to go into the book of Amos. So let's begin to read the book of Amos, and the Lord will bless us. It's not easy. If God is sending you, I've showed you in chapter 2 what we ought to do. People that have really... have excuses. Let's not have excuses. God is sending you. You get as it be, mommy, you know, it's not easy. I didn't know that this is, somebody will say that, I didn't know that, those of you that are getting married, I didn't know that this is how marriage is. So, wow. You didn't tell me, before I come, I have to cook, I have assignment, I have this, my husband is here. Here we go. The Lord knows, but we have to still be committed to God. Your prayer time must really be going on well. Your fellowship time with your children must be going on well, because when they get to that age, it's difficult, my dear. You can't tie them anymore. They begin to come with a lot of characteristics. You can't understand the dictionary anymore. That's why you have to bring them here so that they can listen to the same word, they can hear the same word, you can be teaching them at home in the car, everywhere, Deuteronomy chapter 6, so that the word of God will part of them. And the Lord will continue to help us. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. That takes us to chapter 3, which is very, very interesting. I told you it's divided into two sessions. Jonah refusal to go on a mission, and the fulfillment. Jonah chapter 3 and 4, we now see here about Jonah forsake his mission. May we not forsake our mission in chapter 1 and 2, in Jesus' name. Though he was a prophet, he felt he can run away from God. But it has limitation. You cannot. So Jonah fulfills his mission. May we fulfill our missions in Jesus' name. And the Lord commanded the fish, and he vomited Jonah onto dry land. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. This is the second time that the word of God came to. I love that reference from one of our sisters, that the word of God came to Jonah the first time. But in disobedience, he was not able to do it. After reading from the book of Jonah, when the word of God comes to us, may we go for it in Jesus' name. Amen. May we not refuse like Jonah. Amen. The word of God can be coming to you. It's not because of what you want to gain. A lot of people do things for God because of what they want to gain from it. But God is looking for people that is not gaining anything. There are many people that are dying outside there. There are many people that still need the word of God. There are many families that are breaking. There are husbands and wives. There are wives that don't know their left from their right. When their husband says one, they have said 100. They don't know that they need to be calm. They don't know that they need a servant heart. They don't know that you have to be full. They don't know that you don't, like I tell all these young ones that are getting married, that said, when you marry your husband is in God. Your husband goes to church. Number one foundation is laid. Number one foundation is laid when you marry a man of God. Go to people that are not married to men of God, then you'll be able to know. That's why you must know where you are picking your husband from. There are unbelieving believers that are men, they call themselves men and women of God or men of God. They are not men of God. They are full of the world. But because they want to get a Christian woman, they will come to church. They will do everything. They will be armor. They will be cutlass. They will be shield. They will be everything. Even the group that is not started in the church, they will be part of the choir. Once they catch you as that young lady now, because they know, then they will start. Must we go again today? They begin to give you excuse. If you are such a woman, giving your husband an excuse, because I know a lot of young men in the church are working so hard, it's their wife that is a problem. And a lot of young women are working so hard, it's their husbands that are problems. May the Lord help us. Because when God gives you a Christian man, and then you begin to have excuse, are you still going today? Apostle has that grace. I don't think you have the grace. Is that you in the house? We all get there in Jesus' name. Amen. We don't have the grace. Only God that gives us that grace. I tell you, it's not easy for me. Because sometimes I'm crying. You can see me here throughout last week. How many people know that? Even last week I was seriously sick, but I pretend. But when it gets to Friday, I can no longer pretend. I was like, I'm not going to come. But I know that the hand with which I'm going to carry telephone, it's going to weigh me down. So let me come. Let them see me. But I'm sorry to deviate. Food, finished food. I think I have to be ill. So I'm not cooking. I'm just eating. Mommy, you are sick. And different kinds of pepper were coming in. And I was enjoying myself. Even tonight, I still have something that I have to take. Medication. I say, thank God for your lives. I appreciate you. But what I'm saying is that you must give your all to God. You must either, I'm not saying that, I can't. If I can, you can. Because I went through it all. Amen. So, we must not have excuse. In order to fulfill our mission for God, Jonah goes to Nineveh. Now, Jonah hearken to God. May we hearken to God in Jesus' name. Amen. Then chapter 3, then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. May it come to us, let it come the first time that we hear God, we must continue to do good. Go to great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. It's the word of God that has come to the man of God that he came to this country. The word of God came to him and he came here. Look at what has happened now. Peradventure, Apostle Williams did not yield the yield to the Lord and come here, we are not going to be here today. Some of us would have been in the world. Some of us would have been doing what we like. Peradventure, a possibility did not come into my life. Some of you need to hear that story. Maybe I too will be somewhere that they are telling me, and it's like I might have given birth, maybe follow different, you know. Because I was on the verge of doing that, what the enemy would do would have been bring somebody to confuse my life, and they would be taking me to a different thing. The first party I ever attended in my life, I met Apostle Williams. And he said to me in that party, I want you to be my wife. And if you are going to be my wife, you will clap your hands for Jesus, you will shout hallelujah, and you praise the Lord. And I'm still praising today. I'm still clapping my hands for Jesus, and I'm still praising the Lord today. That's the only message that was used to woo me. And I was like, what? I'm thinking of leaving this stuff because I was on the verge of leaving the SU. We have been beaten. We have been caned. We go to the evangelist. You go to evangelist. You come back. My back. I have marks. They cut the trunk. Fine, fine. You don't want to. We invite you to a party. Fine. I have to lose classes because of it with the teacher for terms. But I came second. I would have been the first because I didn't use his words. God is still God in the midst of all these things. So that was all what I was thinking about. And I'm about to leave. No more mission. All this talking about God is God. How come he's letting my parents behave like this to me? How come my parents are not giving their life to Christ? And I'm doing it by force. Are you in this world or this world in you? My brother, tell me. Keep on doing it, CC. Keep on wearing labu. Evangelism is like, you will go to really penalize, is to fight. And you think, and that is, we really mean it. My sister, keep on wearing lipstick. Keep on doing your makeup. Keep on doing it. It's a lot. They will beat you. What are you talking about? They beat you. And this is my mom again. That is another one in the house. She's another one in the house. What kind of... We see people going to church here. Which church is your own church? They don't wear this. They don't wear that. Too much law. Okay, what do you want to wear? She will still encourage me to take my hat. Don't you see my skirt? She will still go and sew a nice skirt, take me to the market, buy nice things for me to wear. Just to encourage, because they see that I'm a good girl in the house after all. But it's with force. I'll go and sing to my mom. My mother tell me, you know? But thank God for today. It has resulted well. I'm thanking God. Because if he didn't lead me to Apostle Williams, where will I be? Because that 7 men came to me in that party. 7. Apostle was the 7th. Number of completion. I used to tell him that he's afraid. He was afraid. can't come to me. Oh, you may. After you marry your wife, then you begin to talk in the house. No. Where he wants to talk, I said, no. Remember that you were not able to talk. You know, when the girl was still there, I said, you can't talk. That's why a lot of you girls, you must keep yourself so that when you get married in the house, you say, you didn't get me so cheap, my dear. You know, you flex your muscle a little bit. And the Lord will help us. Amen. But God knew that I have a mission in England here. And he set me as the forerunner to go first. Then I began to bring all of them, Apostle Williams and the rest of them. And God now spoke to him that he's spoken to him for a long time. But because God has used me, if I didn't come his path, this vision will not be accomplished. But I thank God for bringing me. So we will all fulfill our mission. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. But it will not be second time. Like maybe yours might be second time now because God is speaking through me. Go to the great city of Nineveh. I don't know where God is sending us. Is he telling us now to go to this place where there is war? Afghanistan, the rest of that. I don't know how we can be. I'm telling you, Syria. I know it's ahead. That's it. Yeah. So if God is saying, let's say even personally come to tell us now, maybe fish will have to carry aeroplane. I don't know what's going to help us to fulfill that mission. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Jonah obeyed. I want you to underline that word. May we obey the word of God and go to where God is sending us. Isaiah chapter 9 was talking about who shall I send and who shall go for us. Said, here I am, send me. May that be you, in Jesus' name. Now, Nineveh was a very important city. A visit required 3 days. On the first day, Jonah started into the city. He proclaimed for 40 more days, and Nineveh will be overturned. That is, Nineveh will change. The Ninevites believed God, which Noah did not expect. They declared a fast. Shows that God himself has gone ahead, because if God is sending you, he will go ahead of you to prepare the people that he's sending you to. God was sending me to my family. He went ahead to prepare my family. Even with my gra-gra and everything that we're using to convert them, they still heard God. They will tell everybody that, oh, I want to talk now. Nobody should talk because I'm bringing Bible. God prepared my people at my place of work. In those days, they prepared them. When I'm on my standby, I will see anyone that sits near me. I would have prayed and said, God, bring people that will hear me, not people with stony heart. Bring people that you have touched their heart, so that when I'm talking, the heart of flesh will absorb what I'm saying. And I tell you today, a lot of them are hearing testimony left, right, and center. Even in this church of God today, I have my colleague that we have been together. We will crack jokes and everything. And we talk like we used to talk in those days. And he said that, I'm happy I'm here. Because of you, I'm here. He called me the lady with the little Bible. And I'm happy to bear that name. Amen. When somebody heard that, the husband has a church somewhere there. He said, I'm not surprised. I want to join that church. Through him, a lot of people have joined this church too. May the Lord use us as light in our generation. So he now says, they declared a fast. God has prepared them already. And all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne. Even the king has been prepared when the news got to him. He came from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself with sackcloth. That is humility. That sackcloth there represents humility. And sat down in the dust. These are the way that people repent in those days. Then he issued a proclamation in Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let any man or beast, herd or flocks, taste anything. You know, I always remember this. I don't forget this. Even the chicken did not eat. Do not let them eat. The dogs are not eating. The goats are not eating. Everybody fasted. They used to use it to teach us in those days with signs. They say, all these things, I will never forget. It's always in my head. So everyone fasting. And when I'm preaching in those days, I use this scripture like, even the chicken did not eat. So anybody's not eating in this house. We are all fasting. It is like, I have to be a mandate. You need to see me crazy for the Lord. But I'm still crazy for the Lord anyway. Do not let any man or beast, herd or flock, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink. So this fasting of not eating and drinking, this one that we have to put a little bit of chewing gum, this one that we have to drink water every minute. I'm thirsty. I'm fasting. Fasting. Oh, I have to lick some sweet. Oh. So you know that we have got apostles declaring fasting now. It has to be Jonah's type of fast. Thank God for a country like our country. In London here, a lot of people will be drinking and merry. Before you know it, like doing wild fasting, eating banana and all the rest of that. And then they say you are fasting. What type of fast is that? Or doing Daniel's type of fast. Do not let any man or beast, herds or flocks, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. let them give up their evil ways and their violence. You know, if I've told you about Nineveh, they are wicked people. Who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he had compassion and did not bring upon them the destruction he had threatened. When you read chapter 4, Jonah was not really happy. You know, hence all the miracles of the vine that we talked about, which we are going to go into next week. Amen. Let me just quickly read a little bit of this. In this chapter, Jonah fulfills his mission. We also see God's love and great patience towards Jonah and the people of Nineveh. God is loving and God is patient. Amen. Amen. Even with Jonah, he had compassion. With the people of Nineveh, he prepared their heart before Jonah got there. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, that he should go to the great city of Nineveh and preach some message of repentance. He gave them the message he gave them the first time, the message of repentance. Nineveh is a city important to God. And in this city, a visit requires 3 days. Jonah obeyed the word of God and went to Nineveh and proclaimed to the people that 40 more days and Nineveh will be overturned. But the people repented. Amen. Amen. Jonah was thinking, if you tell them 40 more days, this nation will be destroyed, that they will not even repent. Do you understand? But when they heard, God had prepared their heart. I want us to have this prayer points in our hearts, that while we are yet speaking to unbelievers or to sinners, they will repent. Amen. That God should prepare the heart of this nation for us. The Bible says nations will come to our light. We should go and prepare their heart like he prepared the heart of the Ninevites. He said the Ninevites believed God and they repented. Even their king, animals too were made to fast. And that shows that in your house, you know, like I'm just giving you because this is what was happening to me in those days. When I'm in my house like this, if I declare everybody is fasting, everybody will fast. Even my mom, we said, Oga has told us to fast. She will use it in her own way. She'll call me Oga. She said, Oga has told us to fast. We have to fast in this house. So don't eat anything. When Oga wants everybody to fast, we should fear God. We should fear Oga's sake because they call me Oga because my own evangelism is with terror. The Lord will help us. So when we are fasting in the house, make sure that we involve our home. As for me and my house, the Lord shall we serve. I end my case here tonight. Is there any question? Is there any addition? Is there anything before I hand over to the man of God? Because we have to round up. It's 10 minutes past 9. Go straight to offering time if there is no. Yes? Any addition? Maybe God is saying something to you. I've finished. Okay, time is gone. Praise the Lord. Let's put our hands together for the Lord. Mm-hmm. Let's read chapter 4 before we come next week, and we are going to round up the book of Jonah.
I will interview you, every one of you, because you have congratulatorily finished in quantum, the book of Jonah. Where is Nineveh today? It's in the country of Iraq. It's one of the ancient cities that up till today is still bearing Nineveh. It didn't change. So you can understand when you have the situations happening in nations around that region, the same thing that happened in the Bible, the same spirits that worked in those nations are still oppressing the nations. they repent, it goes, it attacks them back again. So we have a duty like Jonah to those nations. But I'll interview you on what you have learned.
Yes.
Pastor Nick, come and take the offer.
Praise the Lord.